All right, let's go.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the public hearing on the proposed implementation of the Pulse Dempster line and changes to Route 250 on Dempster Street. Today is Friday, July 15th, 2022, and our public hearing begins at approximately 12 o'clock. My name is Christopher Canning, and I am serving as the hearing officer for these proceedings. I represent a North Shore suburban Cook County on the PACE Board of Directors. And we welcome all those who've joined us via Zoom, on the phone, and online. This hearing is being held virtually in conjunction with one other virtual public hearing in Northeastern Illinois. It is required by the Regional Transportation Act of 1984. Now, before we get started, I want to describe how this hearing will be conducted because it's virtual, so everyone understands the process and all the participants have an opportunity to be heard. So we're here today to ask the public for feedback on proposed implementation of the Pulse Dempster line and then corresponding changes for Route 250 that runs along Dempster. In a moment, staff will summarize the proposed changes and then I will open the public hearing for public comments that pertain only to those proposed changes. So again, we're only talking about the Pulse Dempster line and changes to Route 250. If you have any other input on anything else related to PACE, we can deal with that offline, but the public hearing today is only for public comments related to these two lines. Now, if you do have comments that are unrelated to this, we ask that you contact our customer relations department by email at passenger.services@pacebus, that's all one word, PACEBUS.com, or call 847-364-7223, option 3. I'll repeat, 847-364-7223, option 3. Now, other than me, all the participants in this hearing are currently muted. When it's time to open a hearing to public comment, we will call your name and give you the ability to unmute yourself to make your comments. We appreciate you for keeping your comments focused on the proposed changes to the Pulse Dempster line, as well as Route 250 Dempster Street. This hearing is being live streamed on YouTube with closed captioning. It will be available for future viewing at pacebus.com. Finally, and I really mean this, your comments are very important to us. We'll be considering them in our next Board of Directors meeting on Wednesday, August 17th, 2022 at 9 a.m. And I can tell you from chairing many of these meetings, the staff does a great job making sure all the directors know about all the comments that we receive from different public hearings. And I know those comments the directors consider when making a decision about route changes or capital projects that we are undertaking. Now, for those of you who are watching this hearing online, you can make your comments on the PACE website at pacebus.com/public-hearing-feedback. Let me do that one more time. pacebus.com/public-hearing-feedback or by email at public.hearings@pacebus.com or by telephone at 847-354-7943 or by regular mail by sending it to PACE, Community Relations Department, 550 West Algonquin, that's spelled Algonquin Road. That's in Arlington Heights, Illinois. The zip is 600005-4412. As I mentioned, all the comments received either at this hearing or via the other means or the prior hearing will be added to the public record that is provided to our board for consideration at our meeting in August. Now, After that preamble, I'd like to introduce you to PACE's Chief Planning Officer, Eric Llewellyn, who will provide background on the PULSE program and an overview of the proposed operating plan for the PULSE dumpster line and Route 250 Dempster Street. So Eric, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Director Canning. As Director Canning mentioned, I'm going to provide a brief overview of the proposed operating plan for the PULSE dumpster line and Route 250 Dempster Street. As part of PACE's strategic vision plan, Vision 2020, PACE identified a network of corridors for arterial rapid transit lines, which we have branded as PULSE. PULSE provides fast, frequent, and reliable bus service using the latest technology and streamlined route design with the goal of improving suburban travel options throughout the region. PACE's first line, the PULSE Milwaukee line, was implemented in 2019 and operates along Milwaukee Avenue between the Golf Mills Shopping Center in Niles and Jefferson Park Transit Center in Chicago. Six additional corridors have been identified for near-term development, including Dempster Street, which is the subject of today's hearing, 95th Street, Halsted Street, Cermak Road, Harlem Avenue, and Roosevelt Road. PACE initiated the planning phase for the PULSE Dempster line in 2015 to develop initial design concepts and preliminary station locations. Coordination continued during the environmental analysis and advanced conceptual design, which was completed in February of 2018. The project then advanced through the final design phase, which was completed in 2020. Next slide, please. As with all of our service, the PULSE dumpster line is designed to complement and support a larger mobility network that creates a safe, efficient, equitable, and environmentally responsible public transportation system for all. Benefits include faster bus travel and greater frequencies, connections to major destinations and improved links to other bus routes and transit services, bicycle and pedestrian connectivity and AD accessibility, improved reliability due to new technology like transit signal priority, and enhanced stations with passenger amenities, including modern heated shelters, Wi-Fi on buses, and USB charging ports. Next slide, please. PULSE stations are ADA compliant and will feature elevated platforms for near-level boarding, which will reduce the time the bus has to spend at the station, reinforced concrete pad to prevent roadway wear and tear, heated shelters, pavement snowmelt systems within the platform, vertical marker for easy station identification, equipped with real-time signs, bike racks, trash receptacles, and each station also includes opportunities for community expression. The back shelter panels include designs from our local municipalities and other partners. Next slide, please. The PULSE Dempster line, shown in orange, would operate along Dempster Street between the CTA Purple Line Davis Street Station in Evanston and the O'Hare Multimodal Facility in Chicago. PULSE would add more frequency to the corridor, serving the most popular boarding locations, and would also be complemented by Route 250 service, which would continue to operate between the CTA Purple Line Davis Street Station in Evanston and the O'Hare Multimodal Facility in Chicago. The PULSE Dumpster Line stations, currently under construction, will be located at Davis Station in Evanston, Dodge, St. Louis, Crawford, Dempster Skokie CTA, Austin, Waukegan, Harlem, Milwaukee, Cumberland, Western, D, Des Plaines Metro, Oakton, Lee Toohey, Higgins, and the O'Hare Multimodal Facility. Dempster Street is an ideal location for PULSE service because it is a heavily traveled corridor with transit supportive densities and sidewalks, as well as connections to major destinations and other transit services, including PACE and CTA local bus routes, the PULSE Milwaukee line, Metra, the CTA yellow and purple lines, and O'Hare. Next slide, please. On weekdays, the PULSE Dempster line would operate from 5 a.m. to 12:15 a.m. with service every 15 minutes at the peak and every 15 to 20 minutes in the off-peak. On Saturdays, service would begin at 5:20 a.m. and on Sundays at 6 a.m. On both days, service would end at 12:20 a.m. and operate every 15 to 20 minutes all day. With the improved frequency and hours of service proposed on the PULSE Dempster line, PACE anticipates that the majority of current Route 250 riders would use the new PULSE service. As a result, PACE is proposing to reduce the frequency and hours of service on Route 250. On weekdays, Route 250 would operate from 5:30 a.m. to 10:19 p.m., with service every 30 minutes in the peak and every 60 minutes in the off-peak. On Saturdays and Sundays, service would begin just after 6 a.m. and continue to just after 10 p.m. and operate every 60 minutes all day. Overall, the proposed operating plans for PULSE and Route 250 would increase service in the corridor by 109%, while also providing faster, more frequent service along the corridor throughout the day. Director Canning, that includes my summary of the proposed operating plan for the PULSE Dempster line and Route 250 Dempster Street. Thank you.
So Eric, I don't know if you've noticed, there are a couple of media stories that talk about how the Pulse line will be getting people to O'Hare. In a perfect world, how fast could people get from Evanston to O'Hare?
So under the new schedule, there's a savings of around, I believe, 8 to 10 minutes, depending on time of day. But if I can, I'd like to turn that over to Alex real quick, if you can provide a general summary of what the running time changes would look like.
Sure.
Thank you.
So as Eric mentioned, my name is Alex Garcia, and I'm PACE's supervisor of scheduling. And for the Pulse Dempster line, we're looking at an overall savings of 8 to 10 minutes per trip, which means that the fastest trips that we're anticipating going from Evanston to O'Hare is in the range of 47 minutes or so. While during the rush hours, due to traffic, it might take a little bit longer. And, and during those rush hours, it might be closer to a little over an hour to an hour and 5 minutes, which is still, looking at 8 to 10 minutes of savings per trip. So it will still get you there faster than the current 250.
And Alex, what do we anticipate the fare to be?
The fare is going to remain the same as the current about 250. So if you are using Ventra, it'll continue to be the same fare. And if you're using cash, it'll continue to be the same fare.
And for people watching us on YouTube or listening in, how much is that?
It would be $250 for cash and $225, I believe, for Ventra.
Yeah, it'd be $2 and $2 for Ventra, $225.
Yes. Thank you, Eric.
And Alex and Eric, any way you cut it, it's less than a gallon of gas, and it's less than an Uber and less than a 303 taxi.
Absolutely.
Okay. Just want to put in perspective, because we know that our riders have other options, and this seems to be a very economical as well as efficient way to move people from Evanston and other communities north and northwest of the downtown business district out to O'Hare if they're going to leave town or come back into town. Okay, Eric and Alex, thank you very much for your presentations. We are now going to open the hearing for public comment. And this is how we're going to do it. I will find something on my desk to officially open the public hearing. We will then have staff call one person at a time. And when you hear your name, you will be given the ability to unmute yourself and provide your comment. So now, due to the number of attendees we have today, I would ask that you try to keep your comments around 3 minutes. We're not going to be the gong show and pull you off, but if you could just try to keep it around 3 minutes, we would appreciate that. So I will take my official water cup here, and I will gavel the public hearing to a start. The public hearing is now open. Steve, please call our first registered speaker.
Director Canning, we have 3 members of the public present at this time. Our first speaker is Russell Hambelton. Russell, you should now have the ability to unmute to share your comments. Welcome.
Good afternoon, Russell. Welcome. I see you in the bottom right-hand corner, but you appear to be muted, Russell.
We'll give Russell a few more seconds, and we'll circle back to him again at the end if he does unmute. Okay, at this time, I'll call our next speaker, Gina Mori. Gina, you should now have the ability to unmute and provide your comments. Welcome.
Good afternoon, Gina. Welcome.
Thank you. Welcome. Thanks for welcoming me. My initial question was, because I was trying to understand this, these proposed changes and what the Pulse line entails, was what criteria will be used to decide which of the 250 bus stops, the current bus stops, to eliminate.
And was that your only question, Gina?
That's the question that I used when I registered. I was looking at your slides and trying to, I probably have another question after that. Do I need to come formulate all my questions right now?
Or do we? Oh, no. I just didn't know if you had more, because I thought we would address them all at once. That's why I asked.
Oh, yeah, actually what popped up in mind here is looking at your route and the images of what a new Pulse bus stop will look like and the space is going to take. I live near Crawford and Dempster, so I'm curious as how they're going to find what the businesses that exist there, how you guys will find this type of space on the sidewalk for what looks, I mean, what looks good, the heated shelter, the signage and everything, so.
Okay, well, Gina, Charlotte is on the meeting and she has been involved with the design of the shelters, both on Milwaukee as well as on Dempster. And this has been a very long process in selecting sites as well as making sure that the stops are built in an appropriate location. Charlotte, do you have anything to add about that?
Yes, then thank you for the question. So the two proposed, or the two stations that we're constructing as part of the Dempster line are located adjacent to the Walgreens at the intersection of Crawford and Dempster, and then the mobile gas station in the westbound direction. We have secured easements for both of those locations. So we are encroaching a little bit on private property, but not by much. So that is all taken care of, and we are able to fit the shelters pretty much within the right of way for both locations as well. We are able to run in a ADA compliant sidewalk through both of the stations as well to make sure that everybody is able to clear all of the street furniture to get any mobility devices or anything like that around it.
Okay, so I understand westbound is going to be by the in front of the mobile gas station, and mm-hmm. you're going to find.
And okay. then eastbound is
by the Walgreens.
By the Walgreens. Mm-hmm. So if you're looking at street view, and actually, I believe we have a rendering of this site on our website.
Okay.
But if you're looking at street view of the Walgreens location, we are going to be just east of the right out driveway. That is there. So currently there's a strip of grass, a sidewalk, and some landscaping on the side of Walgreens. We're going to be slotting into that area there.
Oh, okay. That's in front of the store mm-hmm. windows. Okay, I see. Just past their entrance and that. Right turn only lane.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Well, eastbound. Okay, now I can picture that. Okay, mm-hmm. great.
And Eric or Alex, do you want to go back, and maybe Eric, about the criteria you're going to use or you already have used?
Actually, this one, I'll also defer to Charlotte on, because this would have been in the planning stage. So Charlotte, the question was related to how the station locations were determined.
Certainly. So our station locations were determined on a variety of criteria. Number one, was where the existing 240 or 250 ridership was already occurring. And so we tried to site those stations where we were getting the most riders. And certainly the intersection of Crawford and Dempster was one of those. In addition to that, we needed to see where we had the available space to fit in all of the station elements. Mm-hmm. And then typically one of the other things that we did with citing the locations was to put them on what we refer to as the far side of the intersection. So if you were traveling down the street, the far side would be once you get through the traffic signal. And the reason why we do it that way is because we are able to leverage the transit signal priority technology to get the bus through the intersection, and then it's able to stop and board and alight passengers. That transit signal priority system is enabled when the bus is running behind schedule and we're asked to, the vehicle itself can ask the signal for an extended green or a shortened red to get the bus moving through the intersection a little bit quicker. So it makes the most sense. We're able to take most advantage of that system when we're sighted on the far side, like we are at the intersection of Crawford.
So that leads me to another question. I didn't realize that. Do all the buses have that ability now, or just the Pulse bus is going to be able to control the signals at the intersections?
So it is a technology that we're deploying on Pulse vehicles to start. And then the intention is to expand that to our entire fleet as the system expands.
Oh, I see. Okay. Just Pulse vehicles initially will have that ability. Okay.
That's correct.
Okay.
And just to be clear about transit signal priority, all that the bus can do is extend a green. It can't actually change the light. So just to be clear, the only emergency vehicles are able to do that. For our buses, we're just extending a green so we can get through the intersection, and then the light will change after that.
Oh, okay. So Pulse vehicles will only be able to extend the green. Okay.
Right. It's not the same as you've probably seen with fire trucks and ambulances.
I see. Okay. So that brings circle back to my first question, is whether there'll be other stops that will be eliminated along the PACE route, the existing route.
So under this proposal, we've got two layers of service. We have the Pulse Dempster line and then the local 250. The local 250 will continue to serve all of the existing bus stops that exist in the corridor, whereas the Pulse Dempster line, the number of stops that it would serve would only be the station locations that we mentioned in the presentation. So there's two levels of service. The local 250 will continue to serve all of the bus stops, including the stations, whereas the Dempster Pulse line will only serve the station locations.
Oh, I see. It's like adding an express line, like the purple L line that only
Gina, I think you're exactly right. It's kind of like the purple line and the red line going downtown from the north side.
Very good. Okay, great. Well, I don't believe I have any other questions at this moment. Thank you for addressing all my questions.
All right, well, thank you very much, and as always, you can send emails or call with any other questions, and someone from the customer relations department will get back to you.
Thank you.
Steve, who's our next speaker?
Thank you, Director Canning. I would also like to add for Gina that PACE staff did reinstall the Route 250 bus stop sign at Keeler that you had requested via email. I just wanted to give you a quick update on that.
Oh, yes. Thank you. I was going to email you. Thanks. I just walked by it the other day and noticed it. Thanks for the speedy service on that.
Of course. Thank you. Director Canning, our next speaker is Garland Armstrong. Garland, you should have the ability to unmute at this time. Welcome.
Garland Armstrong, welcome. You're still on mute. There you go. Garland? Garland?
I will note that if anyone is having difficulty connecting their audio, we do have, I believe, a call-in number that was included in your Zoom invitation that you may be able to use as an alternative.
Garland, it looks like you're off mute.
So Director Canning, we could try to circle back to Garland in a moment, but I would like to circle back again to Russell Hambilton. Russell,
please do.
Russell, you should have the ability to unmute. Director Canning, we have no additional speakers after Russell and Garland. And at this time, neither is unmuted to provide their comment. But again, well, I would like to
note. Let me ask you this, Steve. Do you have the Zoom invite handy?
I believe I do.
What's that call-in number? Is that the 847-354-7943 number?
No, that is PACE's public hearing phone number. So if someone wanted to call and leave a voice message for public comment.
My remarks, I don't believe I have that number. Liz, do you have that number handy?
I'm checking right now, Director Canning.
Thank you. Okay, so Russell and Garland, if you look at your screen, you will see it went away. Liz, could you read the number into the record, please?
The phone number to join is area code 312-626-6799. That is 312-626-6799. And then you will need the webinar ID, which is 890-1326-7308. And again, that webinar ID is 890-1326-7308.
Thank you, Liz. Garland, it appears you're unmuted. Are you able to provide us comments? Okay, seeing none, Russell, you appear to be muted. Are you able to unmute yourself?
Director Canning, we do have a call-in number that just joined. So I'd like to call phone number ending 999. I'm now giving you the ability to unmute.
Okay, great. Good afternoon and welcome. The phone number ending in 999, you can unmute yourself.
I got it.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes, hi, this is Chris Canning, the hearing officer, and who's speaking?
It's Garland Armstrong calling from Des Moines, Iowa. How you doing, Director Canning?
I am fine, Garland. I did not know the pulse line went that far.
No. I was just calling in for a public comment on it.
Well, please go ahead.
All right. Yeah. I was just would like to know, since I want to echo about one person saying about for the 250, I want to commend you for it. And I just wanted to make sure, like, whenever me and Heather come back and take the 250, and then whenever we want to see our friends there, like, we usually take the 250 from Thacker Street right there by Thacker and Dempster going eastbound. And then when the Pulse comes, do we have to walk, like, only two blocks over to the Des Plaines Metro station, so in order to get on the Pulse, or where do we get it? Like, since we're, like, when we used to live in Des Plaines, whenever we want to take that going eastbound or westbound, where do we get, like, for the Pulse, like, when we're going eastbound or westbound, like, when we see our friends there at, on Graceland Avenue, and then next block over is Lee Street.
Well, thank you for the question, Garland. Charlotte's able to give you some information about that.
Yep. For the Hi, Garland. For the eastbound trips, you'd be able to get on at the Des Plaines Metro station at the existing stop where we have that turnout there. And then the westbound station in downtown Des Plaines is going to be Nearside at Pearson, just west of the downtown. So we're moving from the existing location by the theater and just to the other side of Pearson.
Okay, so like whenever we're going like westbound over there, and it will go like toward where the Jewels is, right there by the Oakleaf shopping center area, something like that, before you hit Oakton Street for the Pulse.
Yes. So if you're on that portion of the route, that we are going to be stopping at it's Oakton Lee Mannheim. So yes, there's a station over by the Jewel, and I believe the other one is by, there's a bank there. I need to look on Street View.
Yeah, it's Chase Bank.
You're shaking your head. Yeah.
There's a Chase Bank over there, and then I remember, too, on the east part, there is a Bank of America on the northeast corner.
Sorry, I realized you're on the phone. I'm shaking my head. Yes, that is correct.
Okay. And then the regular 250 will still have all the stops in between. So it's a combination of both local and express bus routes together, right?
Yes.
That is correct. Uh-huh.
Okay. At least that's great news. So whenever me and my wife come back again, we are definitely going to be taking that on our ride and see it first time ever, because from O'Hare all the way through there, because this will be a heck of a time to seeing everything getting on there. And the Pulse was so great when we left, and now with the 250 coming, we'll be so happy to see y'all again on there and make sure that this is the best of them all, and especially thanks for the people with disabilities. So I want to give kudos to all of y'all over there at Pace, and then say, and Director Canning, say hi to everybody at the board meeting this coming Wednesday from me and Heather, because we miss y'all, and we'll be back in late September, October as vacation visitors. So we'll be back over there at the headquarters to see y'all down the road.
I will let everybody know and say hello to Heather from all of us.
All right. We certainly will. You take care of yourself.
All right. Have a good weekend, Garland.
You too. Bye.
Bye-bye. Steve, do we have any other speakers at this time?
We do not have any more speakers right now.
Okay. So let the record reflect that it's 12:35. We will stand in recess and await any further speakers. I am going to go to mute as well as turn off my video. Steve, please alert me if we have another speaker so we can take their testimony. But I am going to mute now and stopping the video at 12:35. Okay, we're going to come out of the recess at approximately 12:48. Steve, please call our next speaker.
Gina Mori, our previous speaker, has an additional question. Gina, you should have the ability to unmute at this time.
Go ahead, Gina.
After looking at this, I had the other question. Will the bus driver have the ability, or the only person having the ability to extend the traffic light? Is that going to be up to the bus driver or some kind of technology?
I'll be happy to take that question. The bus driver actually has no control over the traffic signal at all. It is a software that is installed in the traffic signal cabinet and on our buses. So the two are actually able to kind of talk to each other. And so our bus will alert the traffic signal controller if we are running behind schedule. If that condition is met, and the condition is met that we will not negatively impact the crossing traffic, then the traffic signal cabinet will do its mathematical magic and will extend the green light for the buses to get through.
So software driven.
Correct.
Correct.
Okay. And then when you said it won't, it'll also be able to read the cross traffic. Does that mean like if pedestrians had, there's buttons to push to wait for the walk sign. Let's say pedestrian hasn't begun walking, was just waiting for that signal. Would the bus be able to see that, understand that a pedestrian is waiting for the signal to cross the street?
Yes, the software takes all of that into account. And I am not a traffic signal expert, but based on my limited understanding, the pedestrian phase of the signal timings always takes precedent over the granting of the transit signal priority to the buses.
Oh, okay. But if a pedestrian doesn't push those buttons that are on the corners, I usually use them, but many people probably don't. If they don't use them, we're just waiting and waiting. Then they'll have to wait through another cycle of traffic lights.
I believe that's correct.
Okay.
Excuse me. And Gina, this is not a new technology for PACE, and Charlotte can give you some experiences we've had. But PACE has been working with this technology for some time.
Oh.
So this is not going to be a trial run on Dempster.
Oh, okay.
That is correct. I think our experience with transit signal priority goes all the way back to South Halsted down by the Harvey Transportation Center starting in like 2009. So that was our first go at the system. And then Director Canning is correct. Second go with it, with this newer technology that I'm describing, where it's computer software is talking to one another. We deployed on the Milwaukee line. That rollout occurred between 2019 and 2020.
So the Milwaukee line is completed.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Being completed, it has been up and running. I believe it's been successful as it's been reported to the board. Our numbers of rider are not where we wanted them to be, but there's also been a pandemic ongoing. But I believe overall the board as well as staff have been pleased with results. And I think our riders who've used the Milwaukee line have been pleased with the ability to move rapidly through that corridor.
Oh, great. Okay. So is there a targeted date when you guys will break ground on these stations?
We actually did. We started construction in late April, and it's ongoing right now.
Oh, okay, because I haven't seen changes directly in my neighborhood where I describe, but I can.
Yeah, if you get out to the western edge of the corridor, that's where the majority of work has been completed so far. So I believe at last count, we have 7 of the 29 station platforms constructed right now. That number is just going to continue to grow over the months ahead.
Gina, I know I was coming back from the airport a couple weeks ago, and I was going by a construction site, and I wondered to myself what that was. And then I reminded myself, I know exactly what that is. That's the Pulse dumpster line. So it was out by that cemetery past Notre Dame High School.
Oh, okay. I'm familiar with that.
Before you get to Lutheran General.
Oh, okay. So if I'm out that way, I can take a look at the progress. And then you guys are just heading east as you start constructing the next ones, but there'll be 15 Pulse stops total on this bus line, right?
15 stops or station pairs. So there will be 29 station sites in total. So that would account for eastbound and westbound station sites.
Oh, right. That makes sense. So when I say 15, yeah, I'm not counting both the east and the westbound that each have to be built.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I see. All right. Okay, well, we're experiencing a lot of construction at the intersections here of Dempster, Skokie Boulevard, and Nile Center Road. So, but that doesn't appear to be, well, that area is congested enough. That doesn't appear to be a place where you're going to erect anything because the Skokie Swift will be the next Pulse station there.
That is correct. And if you're pointing out the stations in Skokie, you are correct. We have not started construction on those. Those are going to be in our next batch to get started.
Okay. So is that something maybe you guys will get to this fall, or we have to wait till next spring?
Under the current construction schedule, we have those being worked on between now and then. Again, the current construction schedule that we have shows all of the station platforms being completed this November. But, you know, that is subject to change depending on, you know, how things work out in the field.
And I believe there's also a strike ongoing, correct, Charlotte?
Yes, there's an aggregate strike right now. So that is limiting some available pavement materials for the region.
Oh, okay. That's why November is just a target, but not... Yeah, because of these mitigating circumstances. Okay.
Correct. And we are in very close coordination with our contractors. And once we get some schedule update information, we'll be sharing that with our board.
Oh, great. Okay, great. Well, thank you. This the screens that you shared, and especially the map, is really helpful. So thanks for doing all this.
Well, you're welcome, and we hope you will ride it.
I hope, yeah. I mean, especially this ability to get right over to the Skokie Swift quickly and to the airport. I think I'm really looking forward to that.
Well, thank you for your comments and your questions. And as always, feel free to write or email customer relations if there are any additional questions that come up between now and our August hearing. Our August board meeting.
Okay, so this is just the one public hearing, and then you have your regular board meetings.
Correct. But we always will be taking comments up until that board meeting on the Pulse Dempster line.
Okay.
So if something... If later today or over the weekend or any time at the end of the month, another question or a couple questions come up, feel free to send an email.
Okay, well, thank you. And thanks for your hard work and planning of this entire Pulse bus service.
I cannot take any credit for that. People like Charlotte and Eric and Steve and Alex have done yeoman's work. It's a stunning amount of work to do. You have multiple municipalities you have to do to get this done. And when we talk about where to site a station, when Charlotte talks about easements and right-of-ways, it's really down to feet and inches that we have to look at. So the staff has done an incredible job in laying this out. that hopefully will benefit our riders and attract new riders to PACES service.
Wonderful. And I use apps to check when the bus is near my house because I can just walk right outside. So I'm assuming I'll be able to also track the timetable for Pulse on my smartphone.
Alex or Eric, will that be a function that will be available on the app?
Yes, just like our regular buses, you'll be able to see real-time information for our service.
Great.
Great.
And at the stations, we'll have the real-time information for you on the vertical markers as well, next bus arrival. So if you get an opportunity to go out on Milwaukee Avenue, I know Director Canning mentioned the active construction site that's adjacent to Mary Hill Cemetery and Niles. That is the intersection with the Pulse Milwaukee line. So you can kind of see what one of the stations will look like once we get those built on dumpsters well.
Great. All right. Well, thank you all for your hard work and thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Gina. Steve, are there any more speakers?
There are no more speakers.
Is there anyone on the phone?
There is not.
Okay.
And we have reached the end of the scheduled hour, Director Canning.
Okay, so I will gavel the public hearing to a close. And so the public hearing is now closed. And I'd like to take a moment before we wrap up, a reminder for anyone who is watching this hearing online today or in the future, we always welcome your input from our riders, just like I was talking to Gina about. If you have any suggestions or comments, you can submit them using the PACE website at pacebus.com/public-hearing-feedback or email at public.hearings@pacebus.com or by telephone at 847-354-7943 or by mail to PACE External Relations Department, 550 West Algonquin Road, Arlington Heights, Illinois, 60005-4412. So those are different ways you can get your comments or questions to PACE, and we will take it into account before our Board of Directors meeting in August. So thank you very much for everyone who has participated. Thank you to our staff for preparing the presentation that you've had a chance to review. And on behalf of the Board of Directors, I thank you all for attending and best wishes for a happy weekend. Signing off.